I'm really excited about the information I'm going to share today. But you know what? It doesn't matter how excited I am, because a lot of this stuff I'm going to share can be really, really boring. I'm serious. I mean, this is kind of academic and dry material. Right. And so, Jesse, so if you end up taking a nap, I will not be offended. I'll understand. But I'm going to work to make it more interesting and, more importantly, relevant. And because it's so dry, I've got my water up here. So I'm having a hard time figuring out exactly where I want to start, because there's a lot of little bits and pieces that I want to pull together even before I get into the message. But I think I'm just going to start. It's a good thing. Okay, so here's the title, because Patty always wants me to come up with a title, and so often I don't care about a title. I'm more concerned about a message. Wow, isn't that awesome? My wife is, no, seriously, think of how awesome this is. In a situation where she might end up being otherwise embarrassed, she's actually stepping out to help me look better in a public setting. Now, isn't that awesome? Aren't I blessed? That's incredible. I love that about my wife, that she will do that on my behalf, even if she ends up being embarrassed on my behalf. It's amazing to me. I love her, and I love the Lord for giving her to me all those many years ago, and that she's still putting up with me now.
You are blessed, bro. I know.
So a couple of Sundays ago, I did a timeline of what we know written through the Bible. And one of the biggest pieces that came back to me out of that timeline was relationship. And I wanted to do some further studies in relationship. So Mike recommended a book, and I went and got the book. And as I'm preparing for today, and for those of you who don't know, I can spend a lot of time preparing for a 20-minute message, just because I don't always feel competent to share 20 minutes straight through. But as I spent time preparing for a message today, I kept thinking, how am I going to condense this down? I mean, this is potluck Sunday. Everybody's going to want me done, and we're going to go over and eat, right? Yeah, Scott's definitely, yeah, let's get you over. I want to eat. And I don't blame you guys, but I'm going through this information, and it's getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and the message just keeps expanding. And I'm thinking, how can I bring this back to a one Sunday message? Thanks, Mike. Yes, Scott, an eight-hour Sunday. So ultimately, my wife said, you can't do that. And I called Mike, and I said, Mike, I can't do this in one Sunday. And he says, how much time do you need? And I said, at least three Sundays. And he says, you got them. It's like, wow. We have an amazing pastor who's willing to step out of his position and put somebody else in and let them have an opportunity to share a message that's on their heart. And I want to thank you for doing that, for allowing me this opportunity. So God just sets, every time I speak, God just sets the stage for me so well. David's testimony, very first words we heard today were about relationship with God and how our perception of God isn't necessarily accurate, but it won't affect who God is anyway. Okay, so last Sunday during the testimonies, God put it on my heart to point to Scott and say, Scott, you have a word. And Scott looks at me and he puts his hands up and it's like, I do? Because I don't know that Scott really knew that he had a word. And he came up here and he started talking about perceptions and how they can affect your relationship with God. And you guys who are here, remember I walked up to him and I said, Scott, do not preach my sermon. And you know what I realized afterwards? It's not my sermon. That's right. Scott's right. It's the word that God is bringing to the church today. The word that God is bringing today is, you've seen me through a filter that's changed what I look like, what I act like, how I am. Let's get rid of that filter. Yes. So a couple of assumptions. Well, one really big assumption. It's in the title. My assumption is real simple. Your perception of God will always affect your relationship with God. Now, think of this. We all have a worldview. Consider an eighth grader today. They've had more geography, more world history, more political input, an eighth grader, than some of the great minds back through the Middle Ages, back through to when Christ was on earth. Because we have so much information that we're able to gather and disseminate and share. So those who actually were there with Jesus, they didn't have a way to share that information without going in and telling you, Don, about the information. Because there wasn't a phone. They couldn't get on the television. The radio wasn't invented. You know, a letter took a long time to travel. And then in order to get that letter to multiple people, you had to either make copies or you had to share it or you had to gather them all together and read it, right? Yep. Limitations of information. So a lot of the information that we have available to us, the church fathers didn't have at all. It's not that they had to go look for it, they just didn't have it. Okay, so usually when I come up and talk to you guys, I have a disclaimer. And my disclaimer is, this message is because God needs me to hear it. I mean, you guys have heard me say that. And last time I spoke, it was a little different. The disclaimer was, I needed to figure out what God wanted me to learn in my studies. And this time, it's totally different. Because after Scott spoke during testimony last week, I'm already praying. So, what's this all about, Lord? And he told me then, and I told you guys, but I'll tell you again. He said, Marcus, it's not about you. Like, whoa. So you're going to use me for something outside of me this time? He said, yeah. Get used to it. It's like, no, really. You guys are smiling at me. For me, that's a big aha moment that God's willing to say, it's no longer just about you having to hear for your purposes. It's time for you to start sharing with others. So when I go through this information, if I don't rock your worldview, and what I mean by rock your worldview, if your worldview is solid, set, and you've got it, you know it, and if I don't break out some of that foundation so that it's starting to tip, then either of two things. Either I didn't prep enough, I didn't do my work, or you're not listening. So, oftentimes, we don't even know where our worldview, where our bias originated. So I'm going to dissect some of that Christian bias today. And hopefully, I'm going to make it interesting enough that you guys are going to not only enjoy it, but you're going to carry this with you. And it's not so that you guys have your worldview rocked, although I hope I can do that to you guys. But it's also because you're going to meet a Christian whose perception of God is keeping them from moving forward. You're going to meet a non-Christian whose perception of God is keeping them from being willing to enter into relationship. And if you know some of those filters, some of those biases that have been promulgated for centuries, millennia, you'll understand how, perhaps, that you can give them that little bit of information that's going to break that wall of resistance and allow them to enter into relationships. So this is part of that building disciples that we do here. Okay, I'm going to talk about filters. I'm going to talk about theological concepts and the biblical in parentheses with a question mark, because I want to show you that not all of our filters for the Bible are biblical. I'm going to talk about their origins, and this is the list of stuff I'm going to talk about. Now, I can't do it all today, so I'm going to do it over 3 Sundays. I'm going to be talking today. I'm going to be talking on April 16th, atonement theory, which was down at the bottom of the list. I'm moving it up for Easter. I just think it's appropriate. I'm going to try and condense all the rest of that stuff into April 30th. If I don't get it done, I don't get it done. And maybe Michael will be generous enough to give me another day to finish it. But my point is real simple. I want you guys to be able, when you're talking to somebody else and you recognize their perception is based on one of these inaccurate filters, you'll be able to share with them from the Bible passages that demonstrate that that isn't necessarily correct. So the first one is Calvinism. You guys may or may not have heard of Calvinism. Most people say it started with John Calvin. And this is simply a system. It's just a way to organize how you go through, look at the Bible, interpret what you're reading, and figure out what's trying to be said to us. It's real. Don't worry about the terms. Be more concerned about how to use them, what they mean to you, okay? So John Calvin formalized this system. But guess what? He didn't make it up. He got it from Augustine. Augustine was an Algerian bishop, but prior to that, he was a disciple of, I don't remember the first name, I didn't put it up there, and then he later had Plotinus as his mentor. Plotinus was a student of Plato. Plato was a Greek. So here we've got this system that started in Greek philosophy, Greek thought. Now, you guys have probably heard before, Greek thought and Hebrew thought are not at all the same. Greek thought had some things in there that were, shall we say, God-limiting. And Plato shared that information as his teachings. And his students, Plotinus being one of them, went on to expound upon them and expand upon them and share them with others. And then Augustine picked up on that. Now, Augustine later became a Christian. But Augustine's life prior to that was not necessarily what we would consider a very Christ-like life. And, you know, when I read Augustine's history, I think, oh my goodness, I thought I was stupid. I did some stuff that was really, and I'm not going to even talk about it. But I'm, hey, haven't we all got something in our past that we're not proud of? Thank you, Penny. So anyway, Augustine became one of the primary teachers of the early church. And so this Augustinian way of thought was really, really important to the early church. But you got to remember, all that thought came from a Greek filter. So John Calvin took that and he formalized it. And here's what he came up with. He says, here's the foundational ideas. He says, God is immutable, unchanging. God does not change his character nor his integrity. That's good. Impassible. God is without emotion. Okay, so God doesn't experience emotion. Okay, God's timeless. He's outside of time. He lives in a realm where there is no time. And then he has 5 points that follow this. The 5 main points are total depravity. That simply means original sin. Unconditional election, limited atonement, irresistible grace, perseverance of the saints. This is what it really means. And I'm just going to turn right around and read it to you guys. It means God never changes, not even his mind. Wait a minute, that's not the cut I know. That's not what I've read. God has no emotion, so he can't be happy, sad, angry, etc. God sees and knows everything from the beginning to the end, every little detail, nothing unknown. He's in control. There's a big word, remember it. Of it all. And we humans, on the other hand, are all born with original sin. And we have no ability to master that. And God has already chosen those of us who will go to heaven and those who will go to hell. And since he already knows who goes and goes to heaven and those who go to hell, since he already knows who goes, Jesus only shed his blood for them, the elect, those that are going to heaven. And by the way, if you're part of the elect, you can't opt out. No matter how badly you sin. Once you've been saved, you're always saved. Not one of the elect. Oops. that. Okay, let's talk about some immediate problems with that. So the Old Testament describes many different times and places where God changed his mind. I'm going to go to, and you know, if somebody else is willing to help me out up here in this, I would really appreciate it. I just want to go, first of all, to Jeremiah. I need people with their Bibles who are willing to look up a few scriptures for me. But I'm going to pull one right out of the middle of this first set here. Jeremiah 26, 2 and 3. Could I get somebody to pull Genesis 6, 6? Scott. Okay. And Exodus 32, 14. We're not going to go through all of them. We're just going to go through a few. By the way, okay, I'll let you take Numbers 16, 20 to 35. I don't have all of this printed out. Any of those of you who would like a copy of this stuff, I'm more than happy to get it printed, have copies available, and I'm going to ultimately impose on Patty to do that on my behalf. I am, because she's the one who's got that technical expertise and access to the information and the printer and the copier, so... Hey, you got to keep those who work to make you look good happy.
That's right.
So, Jeremiah 26, 2 and 3. This is what the Lord says. Stand in the courtyard of the Lord's house and speak to all the people of the town of Judah who come to worship in the house of the Lord. Tell them everything I command to you. Do not omit a word. Perhaps they will listen and each will turn from his evil way. Then I will relent and not bring on them the disaster I was planning because of the evil they have done. Okay, so God's already been planning it. I was planning. That's in the past. He's already making those decisions. It's going to happen. I'm going to smite you guys because you've been evil. But This says, I'm already going to do that, but perhaps they will listen and each will turn from his evil way. Then I will relent. I'll change my mind. I'm willing to change my mind. I've already made up my mind, but I'm willing to change my mind. Does that sound like an unchanging God? I didn't write this. God had Jeremiah write it. Scott, you're next. Hold on.
I love it when they do that, don't you? Yeah. Genesis 6:6. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart.
God made man in his own image for relationship. And then he was sorry he'd made us, and it grieved his heart. That doesn't sound like a God who knows everything from the beginning to the end and never changes his mind and how he thinks about things. Don?
Genesis 13, 14.
He's there.
That's what I thought. Okay. So the Lord changed his mind about...
Okay, that's enough. That's right there. That's it. So the Lord changed his mind. That's pretty definite. So the Lord changed his mind.
Bear with me. I'm sometimes horrible at pronouncing some names here. But so we're in Numbers 16, 20 through 30. It says, "And the Lord spoke to Moses and to Aaron, saying, separate yourselves from among this congregation that I may consume them in a moment. And they fell on their faces and said, O God, the God of the spirits of all flesh, shall one man sin? And will you be angry with all congregation? And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, say to this congregation, get away from the dwelling of Korah, Dathan and Abram. Then Moses rose and went to Dathan and Abram, and the elders of Israel followed him. And he spoke to the congregation, saying, depart, please, from the tents of these wicked men, and touch nothing of theirs, lest ye be swept away with all their sins. So they got away from the dwelling of Korah, Dathan and Abram, and Dathan and Abram came out and stood at the door of their tents, together with their wives, their sons, and their little ones. And Moses said, hereby you shall know the Lord has sent me to do all these works, and that it has not been by my own accord. If these men die as all men die, or if they are visited by the fate of all mankind, then the Lord has not sent me. But if the Lord creates something new, and the ground opens its mouth and swallows them up with all that belongs to them, and they go down alive into Sheol, then you shall know that these men have despised the Lord."
Okay, so here, God's just saying, it's time, I'm going to deal with all the Israelites. And then he gets convinced that he should change his mind. And he does. And so instead, he deals with only those, essentially the ringleaders. Okay, throughout the Bible, we have instances of God displaying emotion. Here's a really good one in Luke. Now, this one occurs after Jesus sent the apostles out on their walk through where they were supposed to pray for people and heal the sick and cast out demons and perform miracles in his name all around the land. And they come back to him and they're saying, we did it and it was fabulous and we got all of these results. And Jesus leaped for joy. And in fact, if you read it correctly, it says Jesus was dancing for joy and spinning around for joy for that the apostles had accomplished what he was sending them out to do as a precursor of what he would send them out to do later, right? Okay. Jesus says, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. Now, if Jesus had emotion of that level, where it says he leaped for joy, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. If I'm made in the image of God, and we know I have a skewed sense of humor. Okay, mine's skewed, but God's got to have a sense of humor. Okay, if God were outside of time, why would the Bible paint a different picture about him? I'm not going to go through these because we really don't have time to go through all of them. Think I want to do one though. Let's see. Again in Jeremiah 32:35. Now, this is God. Okay, it starts in 32:26. It says, then the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah. So this is God talking. And he's going through a list of things that he wants Jeremiah to hear and deal with. Verse 35, they built high places for Baal in the valley of Ben-Hinnom, to sacrifice their sons and daughters to Molech, though I never commanded, nor did it enter my mind that they should do such a detestable thing and so make Judah sin. Never entered my mind. That was not part of my thinking. How could God say that if God knew everything in every little detail and really mean it? I mean, if you believe that God knows everything from the beginning to the end in every detail and all the possibilities, then you got to come up with some other rationale when you start running into this kind of a verse where God says, it never entered my mind. I don't have a lot of time. I'm not going to get as far as I hoped. I'm going to end here. Total depravity. Original sin. I think we all have had that concept put upon us in terms of how we as humans need to, you gotcha, need to consider ourselves in relationship to God. So here's the first problem in my mind. If I'm made in the image of God, if I'm made in the image of God, how did original sin get in me? So let's go look in the Bible for when God talks about sin for the very, 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 very first time. Let's go all the way to the beginning, to Genesis 6:6. Excuse me, 4:7. 6:6 was earlier. So Genesis 4:7. This is the story of Cain and Abel. And I'm going to start a little earlier in this. Middle of verse 2. Now Abel kept flocks and Cain worked the soil. In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord. But Abel brought fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. The Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering. But on Cain and his offering, he did not look with favor. God made a decision. So Cain was very angry and his face was downcast. Oh, man, God didn't appreciate what I did on his behalf. Oh, that's no good. Then the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin, first time the word comes up in the Bible, sin is crouching at your door. Sin's not in you. You don't have sin in you. Sin is crouching at your door. It's outside. But here's what God says about sin. Remember, this is what God says about sin. It is crouching at your door. It desires to have you. But you must master it. Wait a minute. I have the ability to master sin? From the time of my birth, I'm not a fallen person. I don't know about you guys. This really messed me up. Original sin. I could not understand how I could be deserving. There's a big word out of the Bible. How do I deserve any of this stuff? If if I had original sin in me. I don't know if it messed any of you guys up, but I'll bet it messed a lot of other people up. If we're not really born with original sin, if we're born innocent, and by the way, do you remember in the Bible God's talking about, or Paul is actually talking about people who actually don't know the law, who don't know Jesus, but who are living not necessarily godly, but good lives. And there's no rebuke on them. But if they had original sin, they'd still have that rebuke. Because you'd have to have that original sin removed in order to have that righteousness from God. If we look at God from these perspectives, and we have, if we're Christians, because Calvinism sweeps through almost all of the Christian faiths and the Christian denominations and the Christian divisions. If you're a charismatic or a Pentecostal, or if you're conservative or liberal, Calvinism sweeps through all of that. It means that somebody's been putting something in front of us so we can't really see God the way God has described himself to us. Okay, have any of you guys ever played a game in your past? I think it's called Jumanji, where you get these little red filters to look through eventually as part of the game to read the code. And you can only read the code if you've got the red filter, because otherwise it's hidden in amongst all of the other stuff that's on the game board. So it only shows up when you're looking through the red filter. Well, let's look at this from the other side. What if we've had a red filter in front of our eyes? Well, what we need to do is simply find a way to get rid of that filter so that we're seeing God clearly. Amen. So we're not seeing God with these presupposed concepts. That when we look through the Bible, we're not saying, oh, that must be because of original sin. Or we make up a story that makes sense because that really can't be God, because God's outside of time. He can't change his mind, really. Or maybe we simply can't, like I was at a place, we can't accept that I'm worth my Savior. He said, you were worth it. Whether you knew me or not, you were worth it. And I thought, but I had this original sin, this sin nature. What if I really didn't? All those years that I debated with myself, that I had this limiting concept of how close I could get to God because of who I was and what I was. I didn't need to go through that. You know how much weight goes off your back when a concept like that comes your way? To me, it was amazing. Maybe someday, and hopefully when I get through all of this, it'll really be in you so that you can take it with you. When you meet that person who is me, and you recognize that they have that filter between them and God, you may be able to show them how to remove that filter so their relationship can proceed. Really, that's number one. I got four more points. But it's noon, and we're going over to potluck. My hope is that I'm going to be able to help you guys see God in a new and more biblically based fashion. So here's my prayer for all of you. Heavenly Father, pour out your Holy Spirit to carry the knowledge and set it not just in our heads, but in our hearts that you want us to hold to, so that that knowledge becomes a part of our ability to minister to others as we move forward in discipleship. And I thank you, mighty God, that you have put your Holy Spirit inside of us for a purpose such as this as well. So I thank you again for your love, for your gracious, gracious love. And Lord, I offer up a prayer of thanksgiving for all of the food that everybody has brought. And I ask that you come and you fellowship with us and you share a meal with us. And I pray this in Jesus' holy name as my Lord and Savior, one who loved me from before when I was born and has chosen to love me, to take me into relationship with you to the end of time.